How good or bad is decaffeinated versus that standard cup of coffee? Does it raise blood sugars and, just importantly, blood pressure readings? The explosion of diabetes and metabolic syndrome has the scientific community carefully and purposely studying decaf in particular because they already see the health benefits of the 1,000+ antioxidants known to exist in coffee beans. And what they are finding has the world in a buzz. Literally. Today, we will discuss the unknown, positive facts about decaf coffee. I bet you did not know. But before we begin, please do not forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way, you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And most importantly, if you've learned something new or revolutionary today, and that is what this channel is all about, keeping you on the forefront of science, then please hit that like button for me. Millions of us, including me, start the day with that freshly brewed hot cup of coffee. It is described as being the world's most popular beverage and is enjoyed for a number of different reasons. Be it for taste or pleasure, for mental focus and clarity, or even as a powerful workout stimulant, it does hold a special place in all of our hearts. How so? We Americans drink more coffee than soda, tea, and juice combined. This channel, however, is dedicated to the health and well-being of us diabetics, especially blood sugar, the A1C, and blood pressure control. With more and more of us becoming health conscious, we all at one point or another question our coffee intake. Is it too much, specifically the amount of caffeine consumed on a daily basis? We know caffeine is that powerful stimulant. One, it can wreak havoc on your sleep, causing bouts of insomnia. Two, if you are a type 1 insulin-dependent diabetic like myself, or a pre-diabetic or a type 2 diabetic, caffeine can and will raise blood sugars. Blood pressure, on the other hand, may be affected in diabetics and non-diabetics alike, especially if it's a concern with your doctor. So, can switching to decaf help reduce insomnia, normalize blood sugars and blood pressure readings while reaping the positive health benefits it does provide? In this one case, I may have great news. Can you have that cake and eat it too? In other words, enjoy all the benefits of coffee, and they are numerous, while limiting the bad. You see, coffee in general provides more than that morning jolt. That steaming cup of Java is also the number one source of antioxidants in the U.S. diet. That is according to a new study by researchers at the University of Scranton. That means we get more antioxidants from coffee than any other dietary source. That includes the much touted superfoods like kale, dark chocolate, and blueberries. Scientists have identified approximately 1,000 antioxidants in unprocessed coffee beans, and hundreds more develop during that roasting process. For those who are drinking coffee strictly for its antioxidants, it should be noted that decaf has just a slightly lower amount of these critical nutrients, and that is due to the caffeine extraction process. And I do caution this. High antioxidant levels in foods and beverages, especially in supplement form, do not necessarily translate into the same levels found in the body. The potential health benefits of these antioxidants ultimately depends on how they are firstly absorbed and then utilized. A process that is still being studied and as of right now is really poorly understood. Another new study showed that brewed coffee contains a good amount of fiber. Yes, I said fiber. You weren't expecting that, were you? The same soluble roughage found in oatmeal and fruits, which aids in digestion. According to the National Coffee Association, 82% of adults in the U.S. drink an average of 3.2 cups of coffee every day. A traditional 8-ounce cup of coffee could contain as much as 1.5 grams of fiber. So that average of 3.2 cups nearly equates to 5 grams. Coffee is quite acidic, and for many, it has to be mixed with dairy to help neutralize the effects. Otherwise, it can lead to heartburn and other uncomfortable side effects. One major benefit of decaf is the lower acidic content. Avoiding unnecessary and/or additional calories, especially sugar, to foods is critical for us diabetics. This whole channel is hyper-focused on keeping that A1C to 5 and under, and that is for all type 1s, type 2, and pre-diabetics alike. That is, we as diabetics have the right to consistent non-diabetic blood sugar readings. That added milk or sugar in even small amounts creates greater volatility to blood sugar readings. The bottom line, over the last several decades, coffee has become one of the most heavily studied dietary food items. And the news is mostly good. Moderate coffee consumption, 3 to 4 cups per day, has been linked with a longer lifespan. In fact, a November 2015 study in Circulation found that coffee consumption was associated with an 8 to 15% reduction in the risk of death. Here's the interesting point. They saw the largest reduction amongst those drinking coffee at the higher ends of that consumption limit. According to the USDA, the average 8-ounce decaf cup of coffee will contain approximately 2 milligrams of caffeine, and it will vary from brand to brand. There are some brands known for having up to 15 milligrams of caffeine. I bet you're asking, how does that compare to a regular cup of Joe? On average, an 8-ounce cup of black coffee will contain 80 to 270 milligrams of caffeine. To put this into perspective, even the same amounts of black or even green tea has more caffeine than in decaf coffee. A regular 8-ounce cup of black tea will contain between 30 to 50 milligrams of caffeine. The next major question I bet you're asking, how do they remove the caffeine from the coffee beans? Well, there are actually four methods. One uses a direct solvent, the second an indirect solvent, third uses carbon dioxide, the gas, and fourth, it's what's known as the Swiss water process. I want to keep this episode short and brief, but if you'd like to learn more, just do a Google search on coffee decaffeination process. So then, that leads us to the elephant in the room. When the word decaf is mentioned amongst the most passionate and purest of coffee lovers, it's as though the world just came to an end. There's the old dilemma, and that is flavor. Many enthusiasts feel as though it's not as full and vibrant as regular caffeinated versions. What is the best tasting decaf method? Really, it's up to you. Some people love the taste that's gone through the commonly used indirect solvent method. For those wanting decaf that tastes as good as regular coffee, try the decaf that's gone through the Swiss water process. However, it should be pointed out that the roasting and the brewing play a major role in taste as well. If you want the best tasting decaf, then I would personally recommend you finding a roaster you really like, contact them, and ask them about the process of their decaf beans and either experiment the brew methods at home or at your local coffee shop. You can even go to your local coffee roaster and ask if they've got a batch of caffeinated and decaffeinated coffee beans for you to try. This is the best way for you to taste the flavors yourself, and I bet many of you would not be able to tell the difference. If you do have a favorite brand, please share that with all of us in the comments section. Let's get to the nitty-gritty, the nuts and bolts of this episode, especially for anyone suffering from blood sugar control or metabolic syndrome issues. Regardless of the taste, is there a difference in how the body responds to both versions of coffee? Is one healthier than the other? We can look to a study called Caffeinated versus Decaffeinated Coffee Consumption and Risk of Type 2 Diabetes. This was a systematic review, a dose response meta-analysis done in 2018. Their main conclusion shows really strong evidence that a high consumption of coffee is associated with a significantly lower risk of diabetes. And that is for both caffeinated and decaffeinated coffee. Longer-term randomized controlled trials are still needed to find the underlying mechanism of how this all works. Research published in 2002 by Diabetics Care announced that caffeine does, however, decrease insulin sensitivity in healthy male volunteers by approximately 15% compared to the placebo. Then, the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition in 2008 published a study, and they too came to the same conclusion. Coffee with caffeine significantly impairs insulin sensitivity in healthy males. But at the same time, the study also showed decaffeinated coffee does not have the same effect. It is therefore believed decaffeinated coffee may present the best option for people with diabetes, as researchers find it includes the benefits of coffee without the negative effects that are associated with caffeine. Let me circle back for a few seconds and explain why the studies show a drop in insulin sensitivity in that caffeinated coffee and why it is so important to understand. The acute reaction is not a terrible thing. It actually can be positive if you know when to leverage it. Simply put, caffeine raises stress hormones like adrenaline, which increases what's known as lipolysis, or the release of fatty acids from stored body fat. The additional boost you get from coffee is partly caused by the increased free fatty acids in the blood and the subsequent and necessary drop in insulin sensitivity. This allows cells to temporarily burn body fat over glucose or sugars. In other words, you become a fat-burning machine for a limited time. It makes perfect sense when you consider the entire picture, but it does sound scary when taken out of context. How do I personally leverage coffee? In other words, I want the best of both worlds. And in full disclosure, I do drink 4 cups a day. My first cup is caffeinated coffee first thing in the morning, 30 minutes or so prior to when I do my fasted cardio. This is where I want the coffee to help me burn more stored body fat, which in the big picture gives me greater sensitivity down the road. My second and third cup, which is around 11:30 a.m. and 2 p.m. respectfully, but they are both decaffeinated. This is where I do not want my blood sugars to rise or experience a drop in insulin sensitivity. My last cup is in the late afternoons, 30 minutes prior to weight training. This is where I do leverage regular for that caffeine. Training is so intense, I need that extra power, focus, and energy. If you do have diabetes, metabolic syndrome, or any health conditions like high blood pressure, check your blood sugar readings and blood pressures on both kinds of coffee. More than likely, you will be able to enjoy decaf whenever you like, and yes, potentially even in the evenings. You can still have that unique taste of coffee and all the positives just without the caffeine. I want you to always remember our number one rule as resilient diabetics. Always let thy food be your medicine. Good food is medicine. Bad food will need you to take more and more medicine. What do I mean by that? It is your diet of choice, first and foremost, that will either make or break your health. If you'd like to learn more, then I'll create a playlist for you on the foods that heal and the foods that can make health progressively worse, requiring you to take more and more medications. The first link you will see is to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second will be the list to the playlist on foods. Have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released bi-monthly. Bye for now.